The views and opinions expressed in this podcast do not necessarily reflect on anyone other than the host or his respective guest. Some know him as the defender of common sense. Others simply know him as that South African asshole on YouTube. For the purpose of this podcast, we simply refer to him as Ronaldo. Regardless of what you might call him, get ready to be slapped in the face with a little known thing called common sense. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the RG Show.
Hey, what's up, guys? It's Ronaldo here, and welcome to the RG Show. This is podcast number 004. Now, today I have a very special guest on the show. This individual, along with his band, gave his generation a voice. His band changed the perceptions millions of people had of his language and his culture. They literally shook the foundations on which Afrikanerdom was built, which is a good thing in a way. His band is known as one of the best in the history of South Africa, and when he decided to do his solo projects on the side, it broke South African records. He was the first South African to get both the number one album and number one song on the South African iTunes chart. He recently launched his latest album to critical acclaim, and he's here to talk about it, as well as his journey thus far. With that being said, I'm very proud to welcome Francois van Cooke.
Hey man, it's been a while. I'm very good. Been lag busy the last couple of weeks, but I'm at home for a couple of days and got to spend some time with the family, so it's all good.
Yeah, no, that's great. I mean, for those of you that don't know, myself and Francois go back quite a while. I think it's 13 years, 14 years, not necessarily as friends, but just that's when it started, and that's when his band toured Port Elizabeth, and that's how we became sort of friends.
I thought we could call each other friends at least.
No, we can.
Not just sort of friends.
Okay, well, there we go. I mean, now we're friends officially. Listen, firstly, I just want to apologize for doing this interview in English. I know that we are both Afrikaans, so it's quite weird to speak English with one another, but I have a lot of international listeners who won't understand a word we are saying if we speak Afrikaans, so I hope that that's cool with you.
I'm 100%, man. No sweat. I'm going to do my best in English. I'm going to do my best.
I have to say, your English accent's almost better than mine. It's very Americanized, which is cool. So,
American, let's go.
There we go. Also, thanks for spending Valentine's Day with me. It's a nice romantic touch. I really appreciate that.
Cool, man. I just had a Valentine's lunch with my wife, so it's all good. I'll take you second.
Well, that's good. I'll take that. Listen, you recently became a dad, so congratulations, bud. And how's the little one doing?
Thanks, man. She's amazing. Her name is Alex. She's just over 3 months old now, and she's just added so much value to our lives. You know, I think I thought I was ready to have a child, and I think in that first month, it's so intense and so hectic, you know.
Yeah, for sure.
I don't think you can actually see all the beauty of it because it's just so intense and such a shock to the system. But you know, like 2 months down the line, it started calming down, and we started kind of realizing where everyone fit in, and it's really amazing. It's amazing seeing her grow in front of us and just the changes every day. It's really awesome.
That's awesome to hear. Yeah, because there's no manual for how to, you know, raise a child.
No. And everything that you hope for, it's going to be different, and everything that you think is going to happen is not going to happen. It's completely, there's no manual whatsoever. I think for us, that we've also been together for quite a long time, me and Lauren, and you know, we kind of were set in our ways, and this just swings the whole thing around, you know. So
yeah,
which is a good thing in retrospect. It's amazing.
So on that though, how has becoming a dad changed your outlook on life and your approach to music?
Dude, I think things have changed quite a bit for me in the last couple of years. You know, I think you know, when I started playing music, I didn't have anything to put it bluntly. You know, I stayed in a yellow room with a mattress. My only mission in life was to try and make the best music possible, take it on the road, play it to people, and party. That was what my life was about when I was 23.
Yeah.
And you know, I did that for a long time, and you know, like when I reached my 30s, I think, and getting married and responsibilities and things that came on board, it changed my outlook. So when I cut down on the partying and got married and got some responsibilities, like already things started changing a lot for me. And I think the way I approached music is also was also different. You know, I think in the last year or so, when I wrote the last album while my wife was pregnant, I obviously didn't have a child yet, but I think I was already thinking about how that will change. But now I think about how the music can serve me and how I can make people happy by making music, and also the immediate people around me first and foremost, like my wife and my child.
Let's talk about your musical life, because it's such a massive part of your life. Now, this year will be 14 years since Fokof Polisikar was formed. And how has your life changed since that fateful day in 2003?
Yes, things have changed tremendously. You know, like I said, when we started this band, it was 2003. We had nothing to lose. I kind of had nothing. Like, and we just wanted to go on the road and play music. And in the back of our minds, we spoke about things like we wanted to create something for ourselves that like Fokof can be the springboard of. And yes, it kind of, I think for all of us in the band, it kind of worked out like that. You know, like for me, 14 years down the road, I'm doing this. I've got my solo career going. Johnny Dredder has got a studio, very successful post-production studio where he makes music. Hunter Kennedy writes for different people. Weinand Mayberg manages different people, and Snake does a variety of things. It takes photos and makes music videos and all kinds of things. So I think for all of us, Fokof Polisikar kind of set us up to do music as a career choice, and I think that was the most important thing. But in that time, obviously, a lot of things have changed, from like the way we view relationships, from the projects we are involved in. It's difficult to actually just sum it up in one one answer. For me personally, a lot has changed over the years.
A lot of people don't know that you're actually a pastor's son. So just to going back basically to the roots, how difficult was it to explain to him what you decided to call the band?
Yeah, that thing, that was quite funny, because my parents knew I was into music, and I went to go study sound engineering after school, you know, kind of with the idea that I want to do sound, but eventually play music. You know, I don't think my parents really thought that playing music was a real career choice. I don't think it was really at that stage in the South African music scene. I don't think there was actually a lot of bands doing it full time for a living, you know.
Yes.
And I studied sound, and I started doing live sound in Cape Town and played in bands on the side, and eventually we came up with the name Fokof Polisikar. We thought, this is a reason to start a band, this is a reason to do this. You know, we've always joked about being an Afrikaans band, but it was kind of taboo because no one was doing anything like that. It was like a funny, like in a ha-ha kind of sense, this Afrikaans band. We came up with a name, we started writing songs, and we realized that we could really express ourselves fully in our mother tongue for the first time. It felt like some kind of a release, you know. We thought we had something special, and we decided that we're going to push through with this Fokof Polisikar name. We're gonna make be good enough so people can see past the name, and you know, but that's going to be the name. I told my parents, I'm quitting my job, I'm moving back into the house with you guys, I'm starting an Afrikaans band, but I couldn't tell them the name of it, because I was a little bit scared of their reaction, and I knew their reaction was not going to be good, so I actually never told them the name. I told them I'm starting an Afrikaans band, and then my cousin, Pierre Greve, he plays in the Jewels Fantastis, he obviously knew the name, he told his parents. And his parents told my mom, and in my memory, my mom cried for 3 days when she heard the name.
Wow.
And she says it's only one day, but you know, I remember three.
Yeah. Now, a lot of people don't know, but your surname is actually Badenhorst. Was changing it to Van Cooke a request by your parents, or was it something you just decided to do?
When the first Fokof Polisikar EP came out, there was a review in Die Burger, the Afrikaans Cape Town newspaper, and it was actually quite a positive review, but obviously people recognized my name, people that was in church where my dad was the minister.
Yes.
So a couple of people from the church started phoning the pastorie, which is the house where the minister stays, and they wanted to know what's going on with the minister's son. You know, is he going crazy? He's in this band with this crazy name and these blasphemous lyrics and whatever. So after that, my mom asked me. She didn't force me. She just said, please don't use your surname in the press anymore. And yeah. I said, okay. In an interview, I just said, yeah, my name is Francis van Cooke now, and it stuck.
Yes. Now listen, obviously many years have passed. Are your parents proud of your achievements now?
Yeah, I think they definitely are. You know, these days, I think a lot has changed with my first solo album. I think because of the success of that, Te Vind Ek Jou, the song I did with Karen Zoid, it was kind of a crazy, the success of that song, I think it reached people that I never did before, you know, from kids to my parents' friends, you know, like, yes. I think that kind of made them proud of me because I think their friends kind of connected with my music for the first time. You know, my parents would come to my house to ask for albums for their friends. You know, that would never have happened in the 10 or 13 years before.
Yeah.
So I think they were proud of me before, but I think they can really feel more of a connection now, and I think they understand the history better now as well because of what happened on that previous album.
Yes, it's amazing how the tables have turned now, hey, from, you know, contacting your mom to saying what's happened to your son to now contacting your mom and asking for a signed album.
I really think it might be some of the same people.
There's no doubt, knowing Afrikaans people, I can assure you it's exactly the same people.
Very possible.
All right. So there's no doubt that Fok of Polisiekar changed the game in the South African music industry, especially in the Afrikaans music scene. Did you ever expect it to be as big as it became, you know, holding a legendary status now in South African music?
I don't think we expected to be still alive by now.
Oh, true. I can vouch on that.
You know what I mean? I think we were very serious about what we were doing when we started this project, and like I said earlier, we wanted to set up something for ourselves to create a future, but I don't think we were thinking, you know, like 14 years in advance.
Yeah.
I think we were very serious about being a good band, and we were very serious about our product and what we put out and the visual side of it and everything that we put out there, but I don't think we thought that far in advance. We wanted to make a difference. I think we wanted to make music for us and the people around us, and we wanted to make music that mattered, that wasn't just a passing fad or something. We wanted to make, I think we wanted to create something like that, but I don't think we ever thought it would become what it is today. You know, Fok of Polisiekar is still a growing thing. We haven't released an album since 2008, but Fok of Polisiekar is getting bigger. We're getting more people at our shows. You know, it's like something that like siblings pass down to their younger siblings, and they get into it, and it's like people that go, I don't know, it just keeps on growing for some reason.
Well, it's been about 9 years since you guys launched your last album. When can we expect a new album from Fok of Polisiekar?
We are working on new material as we speak, funnily enough. You know, we've been saying since 2009 that we're going to release an album. And it is 8 years, or how many years is it later? 8 years later. So
yeah,
this year it's really gonna happen. You know, there is about 7 songs taking shape, and we're gonna do a whole crowdfunded campaign for it, so people are gonna be able to get involved and help us make this thing a reality.
Oh, that's brilliant. I can't wait for that, and that's awesome to hear some groundbreaking stuff happening here, so that's good. Now, moving along from Fok of Polisiekar, you know, when they decided to take a break, you started another band with the bassist of Fok of Polisiekar, Wynand Meyburg, and the band was called Van Cooke Kartel. Absolutely amazing band with massive success. So with your solo career also taking off, is Van Cooke Kartel together still, or is it on a permanent break now?
Yeah, Van Cooke Kartel kind of took the back seat when I started the solo thing, but that is also the reason why I have a solo career, I think. Basically what happened there was in 2000 and 2014, Jason Oosthuizen, the drummer of Van Cocteau, decided he's going to go to America to try and get into a big band, try and break through in the States as a drummer.
Yeah.
And that kind of halted Van Cocteau in its stride there. I think we were actually doing very well. We had two great albums, Wiesbang and Blood, Sweat and Tranen, under our belts, that were really doing well. And we were an amazing live band, and then he kind of left the band. So we had to get another drummer in. That gave me the opportunity to work on something else. And I didn't know what that was going to lead to, but that eventually became my first solo album that came out in early 2015.
Yeah.
So, and because of the success of the solo album, I don't think Van Cocteau, there's really a place for Van Cocteau in my life anymore. I mean, there is Fog of Policicar, and I've got the solo career going. There is actually just not really time to do another project as well. So we actually want to finish that chapter completely, and we want to do a final tour with Van Cocteau this year and finish it off completely.
Did you ever anticipate that your first solo album would be such a massive success?
Dude, I never anticipated the success, but I really hoped it would be successful. I think it was a really stressful experience making that album, because it was the first time that I was completely out there on my own, and I did all the kind of admin around the recording as well. So I was kind of like what you would call a executive producer on the album too. So I booked the musicians, I booked the studio space, I booked the producers, I got everyone together, got the separates to the guys that mixed the album. It was like four different producers, five different studios, three different mixing engineers. It was like admin galore, like I've never experienced, and very, very stressful. And eventually, you know, we got it all together, and the album was ready to go out, and I was so stressed about this thing that I couldn't sleep for like 2 weeks before it came out. I just like couldn't handle the stress, because I was like, you know, this has to set up the rest of my life. This has to set up my career. And then when the album came out, and Te Vind Ek Jou came out the same day, the video for Te Vind Ek Jou came out, it was obviously, it blew out of proportion.
Yeah.
Then I was so excited about this whole thing, I couldn't sleep for another 2 weeks. So like, it was basically about a month that I never slept. I went on sleeping pills just to get back into the swing of things. But it was very stressful, and you know, I obviously hoped for the best, but I never expected it to kick off as well as it did.
So obviously, you clearly have a talent for writing songs, and that realization came after, maybe before, but I mean, you know, the people proved it right, that you were actually an amazing songwriter. And I know that Johnny and Hunter wrote most of the songs for Fog of Policicar. So do you regret not being more involved in the writing process back in the day?
Yeah, kind of. I think it actually, in the beginning of Fog of Policicar, I wrote more than towards the end. I think in that on that first EP, I wrote two of the seven songs and two full songs, you know, that I never did again. You know, from there on out, I just wrote a line here or there, maybe a verse or a chorus here or there, on the rest of the album. So, but I think it worked out perfectly for Fog of Policicar. I think Johnny and Hunter will still stay the main writing team for Fog of Policicar. I think that is what that band is about. I think it wasn't like, yeah, it's difficult for me to say. I would have liked to be involved more, but I think it worked out the way it should have. You know what I mean? Like, I think I only kind of started really getting into songwriting when I started Van Cocteau, and that kind of got me out of my shell, and that that made, you know, like, now I've got my own kind of voice outside of Fog of Policicar too.
Now, obviously the breakout hit on your first solo album was Te Vind Ek Jou. It currently has 2.7 million views on YouTube. And look, I am envious, because as a YouTuber, that is something that you dream on achieving. So fuck you for that, basically. Did you know that you had a hit when you finished recording the song? And I'm not talking about, you know, once it was released. I'm talking as soon as you were in production and finished it. Did you have that feeling that the song was special?
I think we knew the song was special. I don't think we knew it was that special. You know what I mean?
Like, yeah.
I remember playing the song to people after the album was recorded, and but with the rest of the album, and people's reactions were always good after hearing that one. You know, from even like my metalhead buddies, I would play the song to them, and they would get goose flesh, or what do you call that?
Yeah, goose pimples.
Hoenderflesh, yeah.
Yeah.
And you know, I thought, I knew we had something, but I never in my wildest dreams expected the reaction that it got.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I can tell you, because as soon as it launched on YouTube, my brother was visiting, and I literally, he was going through some rough shit, and I played him that song, and he literally just burst out crying. And I mean, you know my brother.
Yeah.
So, I mean, he's going to hate that I mentioned this on the podcast, but
he cried.
It just had this emotional, you know, tone to it, which was amazing. So, with that being said, though, how gutful are you of performing this song?
Yeah, dude, I don't get gutful of those kind of songs. You know, I will probably never listen to that song again in my own time.
Yeah, no, but, yeah.
But I really don't get gutful of playing those songs and seeing how people appreciate it. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
I can even go, you know, I've only been playing that one for like 2 years. I've been playing the song Fok of Polisikar for 14 years. I will never listen to that one again either. But playing it to people and seeing what people get out of that song makes it worth it for me to play it every night.
Yeah. And also, obviously, having such a breakout hit, it sort of makes people think that, you know, that is the song of the album, and they would basically just listen to that song. My favorite songs on your solo album is Behoort aan Niemand Nie and Ek Weet Nie. So it's amazing to see that, you know, a lot of people, I suppose we live in that generation where people want instant hits and they don't really absorb the rest of the album.
Yeah, I find that a little bit sad, you know, because I think that, you know, if I go sales compare, single sales compared to album sales, it's almost tripled what the album sold.
Yeah.
So I really like the album. You know, I think it's an album that you can listen from top to bottom, and it's got like a flow and everything. And
it does,
It works in that way, and like, you know, think some people kind of missed it, but that is the way that I think music are digested these days. You know, people look for the singles, and it's not like, you know, we're from the old school, dude. We're like not young guns anymore.
We
still like the idea of an album.
No, for sure. Did the success of that song make you consider making more mainstream songs, because you clearly come from a punk rock background?
I think what it made me realize, that a topic like love is definitely something that more people can relate to than teenage angst or rebellion or, you know, partying. You know, everyone has loved before. Everyone will love sometime.
Mm.
So I think for me, I also want to write more love songs, because I think I accepted love into my life later. Maybe I was fighting against that thing for a long time. So in a way, I don't know if I would say I would like to write more commercial songs, but I would like to write songs that people want to listen to.
Okay, and what about possibly doing a couple of songs in English to appeal to an international audience?
Yeah, I've also thought about that, and I do write English songs. They just haven't seen the light of day yet.
It's time.
Yeah, I really want to do that. Maybe the next album is a full English album. You never know. I just feel like the songs I write in English, they do not capture my imagination as well as the songs in Afrikaans. Maybe it's because I feel like I express myself better in Afrikaans still, but that's something I would still like to do in the future for sure.
Okay. Now, you have been in the music industry roughly for 14 years, I'd say professionally. What has been your absolute favorite moment since starting the musical journey?
Yeah, it's difficult for me to think of a moment. Yeah, I'll say two. I think Fok of Politica doing Skynheilig at Oppie Koppie on the main stage. There's nothing like that.
Yes.
You know, like,
got goosebumps now.
20,000 people singing your song back to you that know every word of that song from top to bottom. There's no feeling like that.
Yeah.
The other one that also always pops into my mind is a weird one, but also very amazing. And with Van Kokertel, we played in Taiwan. We played on a beach festival, and there was, over 3 days, there was a million people at this place.
Wow.
So we played to something like 100,000 people at the same time.
Jeez.
People that don't have a clue what we're singing, but
but they're enjoying it.
It was quite a weird but amazing feeling too.
Yeah, well, thanks for that. Now, you have done some amazing collabs. I mean, people know Karin Zoid, but you've done Jack Parrow, Devils Fantasties, and Arnu Carstens, to name a few. So my question is, if you could do a collab with anyone, who would it be? What would be your dream collaboration, alive or dead?
Alive or dead, that's quite hardcore. Alive, definitely Dave Grohl. He's like my, I guess, my hero.
Yeah.
If anyone. I'm also a big fan of Josh Homme from Queens of the Stone Age. One of those two would be my alive favorite. And dead, you know, Freddie Mercury.
Oh, again. We just became best friends. We went from half an hour ago, you know, becoming friends to becoming best friends. The best vocalist that ever existed,
yeah,
Freddie Mercury.
He's amazing. I would like, you know, like, I could never sing like that, but I would love to. Would have been amazing doing something with him.
Yeah. Well, so your new album launched earlier this month, and it's called Hierdie is die Lewe. Now, I bought it, and I have to say it's an absolutely amazing album. It's a fantastic sophomore album building on your first, you know, that you brought out. My favorite song is Klein Prys, and it's clearly a homage to your old bandmates from Fok of Politica, right?
Yeah, exactly. That's I've never even thought of writing a song for my bandmates, but I don't know, that's one of those things that kind of just naturally happened in the writing process. And it's just, I just wanted to say kind of thanks for the good times, and I love you guys, I guess.
What is your favorite song on your new album?
I think it's difficult for me to say, but I think My Heart is my favorite at the moment. I think it's because it really works well in the live environment, and it's kind of a style that I like. It's like a progressive rock with a dancey beat, and I also like the lyrical content, and it's kind of a love song to South Africa.
Yeah.
But you know, like a lover can disappoint and hurt you, you will still keep on loving them, but it's kind of sung in that way.
Yeah, it's basically meaning that you know, perfectly imperfect. What is your favorite song out of everything you have done over the last 14 years?
Yeah, that's a tough one, man. I'll put it down to two
okay.
songs.
I'll accept that.
Skynheilig. I didn't write that one, but I feel very privileged to be the guy to sing it.
Yeah.
And that I was part of that thing. And then I think Tufintekyo, just because of the impact it has had on people around me and on my career and on my life.
Yeah, that makes sense. And it's, you know, it's two amazing songs. Now, the album cover is amazing, like most of your album covers that have come out. It definitely has a David Bowie vibe going on. What was the inspiration behind it?
Yeah, actually, we didn't think about it all that much, to be perfectly honest. the photo was taken just a normal photo shoot. I just wanted to get a portrait for a press shot.
Yeah.
And it was also by a great photographer. His name is Alistair Christie. And you know, I am sometimes quite conservative when it comes to the way I look. You know, I just wear black. I don't. I'm scared of change and
yeah.
stuff. And he actually painted my hair pink. Because I had like on the single of Mainstorm had a pink cover, so I think he just kind of thought the pink would look cool. He painted my hair pink.
Yeah.
And I got the photos back, and I thought, oh, I look quite decent in these photos, I guess.
Yeah.
And the guy that designed the album cover, Marvin Marchand Leroux, who's also an amazing artist.
Yeah.
I sent him the photos, and I told him, do you think you can use this on the cover? And he kind of zoomed in on the picture, cropped it close, and that became the album cover.
Yeah, no, well, it's an awesome artwork. How's the launch tour going so far?
Dude, it's been really amazing. We started in Potchefstroom, and we played to like 9,000 students at the RAG farm.
Yeah,
it was great. Went back to Cape Town, played to our friends' family in a new venue in Cape Town District. Was very cool. Then played at the Cape Town Tens at that rugby Joel.
Yeah,
amazing. People were so amped to party. Then flew up to Pretoria, played at the Park Acoustics, which is one of the greatest events in Pretoria.
Yeah, it's amazing.
Then for the rest of that week, I did like interviews and things. Then we played at a place called Veyfeld, which is like a full-on Africana venue where, you know, Tien Jordan, Yonita, Snotkorp, and all of those people play.
Yeah.
And it was like a 1,500 sellout audience, which was amazing. Yeah. Played in Josie to a massive crowd in a new venue, Rumors Rock City, and then played on Dozy's Farm on Sunday. That was the last one that we did, was last Sunday. And now I'm home for a couple of days, and then we're eating the Free State this weekend.
Lekker, man. That's going to be awesome. Listen, yeah. I will put the iTunes link in the description for the listeners to check out. And trust me, guys, it's absolutely amazing, and it's worth buying, so make it happen. Now, with me mentioning that, does piracy play a big part in the Afrikaans music industry?
It does. I think the Afrikaans, if we take South African out of the equation and just think Afrikaans, I think Afrikaans music, if you look at it as a genre, which isn't really, is the only music that actually still sells CDs in South Africa. So the Afrikaans people are still a CD buying public, which is amazing for us that sing in Afrikaans. And I was very lucky that my previous album, my first solo album, actually sold the most albums that I've ever sold in my career from the start of Fok of Police Car in this day and age. It is actually amazing that happened.
Yeah.
To Vind Ek Jou was the first Afrikaans song and Afrikaans album that was on iTunes number one at the same time. That has never happened before. It was the first Afrikaans song to be number one on iTunes. It was weird because that song was such a massive success. It was like it went to number one on radio stations that don't play Afrikaans music, like KFM and Highveld and stuff like that, which was pretty amazing. So that CD actually sold, which was good.
It's a good start.
But piracy is a real thing, and everyone is selling less albums these days. It's something that you kind of have to bargain on. You can't bargain on album sales anymore.
Yeah. Well, okay. Thanks for explaining the musical journey that you've been on. And I won't hold you up much longer. I just wanted to, you know, steer this podcast to the end by focusing a bit on, you know, South Africa. So if you don't mind, I'll just ask you some South African specific questions. Now, I know that it's very difficult for musicians to get involved politically, right? So what I wanted to know is, are you at all politically oriented? And you don't have to tell me who you support, but I just wanted to know if you are, and or do you rather prefer to stay out of politics altogether?
Yeah, I think I watch the news, if that means I'm interested in politics.
You know,
I'm interested in what's going on in our country, for sure. I don't think... The most involved I am in politics is by voting.
Yeah.
So I do vote and I do voice my opinion at home.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, because it's obviously very different for me. I mean, being a politician, you know, so I can respect that. And trust me, by voting, you are actually doing a lot. So thanks for that.
Cool. I have actually played shows in support of a political party in the past.
Mm.
It was weird. I don't know if it's something I would do again, because I just found the people that I worked with on that specific night, the people from the political party, I didn't really found very engaging, and I didn't really get along with them that well on that night. So that's, you know, like something that I would have to reconsider in the future.
And you have to be careful, though, because irrespective of what political party it is, if you perform for them, then it's, you know, assumed that you associate yourself with them.
Exactly. And at that moment, I thought, that's fine. I would You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So,
How do you currently feel about South Africa,
yeah, like I don't know if you've listened to the album. You know, I think you would have kind of an idea. I touch on how I feel about my place in South Africa quite a bit. I think I feel like a lot of people, you know, positive, and I hope that more people could feel that we could tolerate each other from different cultures and different sides of the spectrum.
Yeah.
You know, I think there's obviously a lot of scared people in this country and a lot of people worried about the future, but there's also a lot of people that want to tolerate and want to live in harmony and want to love one another. So, you know, I hope for the best. For me, I'm in South Africa for the long haul, so I'm not running away or anything like that.
Yeah.
I hope for a better future.
I agree. And I mean, that is something that I've mentioned in my previous YouTube videos, is the fact that if most of the people in this country just want to live together, they want to like live their lives and be happy. And then 1% of the population, which equates to about 540,000 people, maybe don't. And that is what the media focuses on.
But I agree completely. It's like the people on the far sides of the spectrum have so much of a voice that they influence, and the media focuses on them so much that we start to think that that is what is going on. But I think the greater whole want to live in harmony and want to have a good future together.
I'm so happy to hear you say that, because that is sort of the focus of my videos. So it's great to hear that. Now, what is your favorite thing about South Africa?
Yes, I actually thought about this the other day. I think it's the beauty. I love staying in Cape Town. I love the ocean. I love that part of it a lot.
Yeah.
And I hate things like the crime and the violent crime and racism. You know, those
Yeah.
things I hate. And I love people that can get along with one another.
Yeah. It is a very much like a love-hate relationship. And
This is exactly what that song is about, that my art is about. It's about, you
yeah.
know, like, you can love this place so much, but there's so much that can hurt you about it as well.
Exactly. But I mean, that is love.
Yeah,
So,
exactly.
okay, the last question for this podcast is, who is your favorite South African of all time?
Schalk Burger.
Okay. I have to ask why.
I'm a massive rugby supporter and Stormer, Springbok and Western Province, and it's the greatest we've ever had.
I agree, but when I imagine Schalk Burger, he comes across as that person when the coach goes to him before a game. And he goes, "Skulky, if you play really well, I'm going to give you a green energy." And then he jumps for joy, runs out, and tackles the living shit out of everybody on the field just to get that green energy.
No, he's actually a very amazing dude. I know him personally, and he's a great dude. I really
I'm
love
just
him.
pulling his leg. I mean,
Cool.
absolutely amazing. He's superstar and one of the best that South African rugby has ever seen. All right, so with that being said, Francois, I really appreciate you spending the last hour with me on the podcast. Thank you for what you've given us. Thank you for what you still will be giving us with regards to music and just your amazing touch on what you consider South Africa to be. And please don't ever stop, and don't ever immigrate, because we need people like you in this country.
I'm not going anywhere, man.
Well,
Thanks.
that's what I want to
Thank
hear.
you. Thank you for your time, man.
Perfect. Enjoy the rest of
Awesome.
your day. Cheers, man.
Like a bro.
And that's a wrap for this week's show. Keep updated to this podcast by hitting the follow button. And if you've enjoyed this dose of common sense, then be sure to like, post, and share with everyone you know. Till later, cheers, and peace out.